Welcome. This tour is brought to you by the Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority, DCA. We have prepared this virtual tour to give viewers the opportunity to better understand and visualize the Delta Conveyance project, its site facilities, and their locations. The detail provided in this video reflects project information as of the fourth quarter of 2024, derived from the final environmental impact report, and is subject to change as the design and engineering is progressed and refined. It is important to note that planning and design of the Delta Conveyance project is ongoing, and that future permits, approvals, and funding decisions are required before DWR may authorize project construction or real property acquisition. Before DWR authorizes any real property acquisition, DWR will follow state law for any future land acquisition for sites that underlay the final project footprint, including procedures for property owner notification and outreach. It is also important to note that once authorized, construction of the various project facilities will be staggered so that not all components are constructed at the same time. The Delta Conveyance Project is located in the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta, approximately 20 miles south of Sacramento. This virtual tour will review the project facilities from north to south, starting at the North Delta intakes, continuing through tunnel shafts, and ending with the Bethany Reservoir. Our tour begins at the intake sites in the North Delta. The intakes are the facilities that divert water from the Sacramento River into the Delta Conveyance System. Prior to construction of the intake sites would serve as shafts that are part of tunneling operations. More about maintenance and reception shafts will be discussed later in this tour. This rendering highlights the key features of a typical intake. The intakes would include cylindrical fish screens which prevent aquatic species from being diverted with the river water. The buried box conduits and gates facilitate conveyance of water from the fish screens to the sedimentation basins. The sedimentation basins allow suspended sediment to settle out of the water that is diverted into the system. The sediment will be periodically dredged from the basins and relocated into drying beds where the sediment is dried. After the water has passed through the sedimentation basins, it will pass through a gate and enter the outlet shaft, which allows the water to flow into the main tunnel of the conveyance system. The Delta Conveyance Project will contain two intakes. The northernmost intake is located along State Route 160, just north of Hood. The site will serve as a reception shaft prior to intake construction. The current land use designation is agricultural. The site is currently a mixture of apple, pear, and cherry orchards and vineyards. One modular residential structure and several support structures would be expected to fall inside the permanent footprint. The second intake is located along State Route 160 just south of Hood and north of Cortland. This site will serve as a maintenance shaft prior to intake construction. The current land use designation is agricultural. The site is currently a mixture of orchards and vineyards. Four residential structures and several support structures are expected to fall inside the permanent footprint. The construction area for each intake would be about 242 acres. Each intake would take about 8 years to construct, and once constructed, the permanent footprint of each would be about 123 acres. Construction-related traffic would be directed to minimize effects on local roadways. This map shows the routes for construction traffic. The next portion of our virtual tour will cover the project's tunnel and shaft features. Because tunneling is a major component of the overall project, we will provide a brief introduction to tunnels and shafts before discussing the individual locations. Tunneling would start at launch shafts along the alignment. The launch shaft is where the tunnel boring machine, TBM, is lowered underground so it can start boring the tunnel. Once the TBM has been lowered into the ground at the launch shaft, it will begin tunneling by removing material along the rotating face of the TBM, allowing the TBM to progress forward. This material, which is called reusable tunnel material, or RTM, will then be conveyed back through the tunnel and out of the launch shaft. The RTM is first tested for hazardous materials, and RTM confirmed not to contain any hazardous material is dried and stockpiled at the launch shaft site. In addition to serving as a starting point for the TBMs, the launch shaft sites will also have areas for offices, equipment storage, batch plant, and miscellaneous construction needs, as well as a network of access roads to move construction material around the site. The TBM creates the structure of the tunnel by installing precast concrete tunnel liner segments conveyed from the launch shaft piece by piece. The launch shaft sites would include segmental liner stockpiles where the precast tunnel segments are stored before they are loaded into the tunnel. Tunneling would proceed from these launch shaft locations to maintenance shafts where they would receive the routine maintenance required to finish the tunnel drive. After maintenance, the TBMs would continue toward reception shafts where they would be pulled out of the tunnel. The project includes 3 reception shaft sites and 6 maintenance shaft locations. This is what a typical reception or maintenance shaft will look like. Reception and maintenance shaft sites look very similar, but they function quite differently from one another. At a reception shaft, the TBM is pulled out of the ground after the tunnel drive has been completed. A maintenance shaft allows entry to the tunnel to allow for any necessary maintenance of the TBM during its operation. Unlike launch shaft sites, reception and maintenance shaft sites do not convey tunnel segments, nor do they process RTM. Therefore, they are significantly smaller than launch shaft sites. This rendering highlights the key features of a typical maintenance or reception shaft site. The maintenance and reception shafts would have an access road for site access and to allow for movement of material around the site. They would also include areas for site offices, a workshop, ventilation system, water treatment system, and power infrastructure. During maintenance or reception of a tunnel boring machine, mobile cranes would work at these sites. All shaft types would be elevated on a hydro-seeded embankment for protection against flooding. Additionally, because the launch shaft sites are much larger and would require substantially more construction workers, these sites would also entail a ring levee in the case of Twin Cities, or levee improvements to surrounding levees at Lower Roberts, to protect the entire site from flooding, not just the tunnel shaft. The northernmost launch shaft would be the Twin Cities Dual Launch Shaft. This launch shaft would be located along the north side of Twin Cities Road, just east of Interstate 5. This shaft is referred to as a dual launch shaft, meaning that 2 tunnel boring machines would start tunneling at this shaft, one tunneling north to the intakes, one tunneling south toward a reception shaft. The current land use designation is agricultural, and the site currently consists of grasses and supports cattle ranching. It also has 2 residential structures and several agricultural structures. The total construction area of the launch shaft site would be about 586 acres. The site would be used for tunnel construction for up to 11 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 222 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. Moving south along the project alignment, the next shaft would be the New Hope Tract Maintenance Shaft. This shaft would be located north of Walnut Grove Boulevard, just west of Interstate 5. This shaft would be used for TBM maintenance as the TBM drives south from the Twin Cities launch shaft to the terminus reception shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and the site is currently row crops and grains. The total construction area of the shaft site would be about 11 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 3 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 11 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The next site heading south is the Canal Ranch Maintenance Shaft. This shaft will be located west of I-5 to the north of West Peltier Road. This shaft will be used for TBM maintenance as the TBM drives south to the terminus reception shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and the site is currently row crops and grains. The total construction area of the shaft site would be about 11 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 2 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 11 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The next shaft is the terminus reception shaft. This shaft would be just to the north of State Route 12, west of Interstate 5. This shaft is a dual reception shaft because it would receive TBMs from both the north, coming from the Twin Cities dual launch shaft, and south, from Lower Roberts Dual Launch Shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and the site is currently orchards. The total construction area of the site would be about 13 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 3 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 13 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The next shaft moving south is King Island Maintenance Shaft. This shaft would be located west of I-5, just north of West 8 Mile Road. This shaft would be used for TBM maintenance as the TBM drives north from the Lower Roberts Launch Shaft to the terminus reception shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and the site is currently used to grow corn. The total construction area of the shaft site would be about 12 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 3 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 12 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. Heading south, the next site is the Lower Roberts Dual Launch Shaft. This shaft would be located on the north side of Lower Roberts Island, just west of North Holt Road. It would have a storage area nearby, on the east side of North Holt Road. This shaft would launch a TBM north towards Terminus Reception Shaft and also launch a TBM south towards the Bethany Surge Basin Reception Shaft. This area also includes levee improvements on the west side of Lower Roberts Island. The current land use designation is General Agricultural Land and Agricultural Urban Reserve. Currently, the site is being used for winter wheat crops. 3 residential structures and several support structures are located within the construction boundary. Additionally, levee improvements required along the perimeter of Lower Roberts Island may also impact existing modular homes and a marina. The total construction area of the sites would be about 610 acres. The site would be used for tunnel construction for about 11 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 300 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The next shaft heading south is Upper Jones Maintenance Shaft. This shaft is just north of Bacon Island Road. This shaft would be used for TBM maintenance as the TBM drives south from the Lower Roberts Island launch shaft to the Surge Basin reception shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and current records indicate this land is used for growing grasses, grain, or row crops. The total construction area of the shaft site would be about 11 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 3 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 11 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The next site heading south is the Union Island Maintenance Shaft. This shaft would be west of Bonetti Road, 1.5 miles north of Clifton Court Road. This shaft would also be used for TBM maintenance as the TBM drives south from the Lower Roberts Launch Shaft to the Surge Basin Reception Shaft. The current land use designation is general agricultural land, and current records indicate that this land is used for growing grasses, grain, or row crops. The total construction area of the shaft site would be about 14 acres. This site would be used for tunnel construction for about 3 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 14 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The construction sites to the south of Union Island Maintenance Shaft are part of the Bethany Reservoir Complex, which serves as the southern terminus of the main tunnel of the Delta Conveyance Project. The primary function of the Bethany Complex facilities is to convey water into the Bethany Reservoir. Within the Bethany Complex, at the south end of the main tunnel alignment, the TBM would be retrieved from the Bethany Reservoir Surge Basin Reception Shaft. This shaft would be located off of Mountain House Road, approximately 0.5 miles south of Byron Highway. This shaft would receive the TBM coming from Lower Roberts Island Dual Launch Shaft. Once it performs this function, it will be converted into a surge basin for the Bethany Reservoir Pumping Plant. A surge basin is a reservoir that protects a system from water backflow in case of an emergency shutdown. The current land designation is a mix of agricultural land and recreation and resources. The site currently consists of a mixture of grasses, grain, or row crops, and orchards. The total construction area of the pumping plant and surge basin would be about 213 acres. This site would be used for construction of the facilities for about 12 years. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 184 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. Within the Bethany Complex, water would flow from the tunnel through the Bethany Reservoir Pumping Plant and into the Bethany Reservoir Aqueduct. The Bethany Reservoir Aqueduct is comprised of 4 parallel pipes, would convey water to the Bethany Reservoir discharge structure and into the Bethany Reservoir, and would be located between Mountain House Road and Kelso Road. The current land use is open space and conservation. The total construction area would be about 128 acres. These facilities would take about 5 years to construct. Once the project is completed, the permanent footprint would be about 68 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. These access routes are the same as for the Bethany Reservoir Pumping Plant and Surge Basin. The southernmost facility of the alignment is the Bethany Reservoir Discharge Structure. The primary function of this facility would be to convey and control water from the Bethany Reservoir Pumping Plant into the existing Bethany Reservoir. The Bethany Reservoir Discharge Structure is located south of Christensen Road on the east side of Bethany Reservoir. The current land use designation is park and recreation. The total construction area would be about 15 acres and would take about 6 years to construct. Once constructed, the permanent footprint would be about 13 acres. This map shows the route for construction traffic at this site. The Bethany Reservoir is the beginning of the California Aqueduct of the State Water Project, which supplies water to 27 million Californians and 750,000 acres of farmland throughout the state. While this concludes our tour of the main project features, it is important to note that the project will ultimately also include mitigation measures such as habitat restoration and a community benefits program. We look forward to sharing information for mitigation and community benefits once they have been determined. For more information, visit our website at dcdca.org.